So there's this misconception that even seems to be perpetuated by some of the websites that, specialize in EDS or, claim to know, well, they do know a lot about it, but there's this misconception that I've got to point out because it really bothers me. And that is that other types of EDS, other than type 4 vascular, are not life-threatening. So type 3 hypermobility, type 1 and 2 classical, that they're apparently not life-threatening. And vascular is definitely the most life-threatening because vascular carries a very large risk of rupture of the main vein arteries, like the aortic, like an aortic dissection and or aneurysm and things like that, splenic rupture. So most definitely EDS4, type 4 vascular is the most deadly. However, the other forms of EDS are, first of all, extremely weighing on the quality of life. They hugely impact the quality of life. Stomach, everything from stomach issues to immune problems, on top of having musculoskeletal pain, very severe pain, because our collagen's weak, right? So we injure everywhere. And EDS is so invisible. Like I said before, we have this soft, smooth skin. We often have like high cheekbones and like elfin-like facial features and look, healthy and pleasant even, pleasant looking, healthy. Even the EDS doctors have almost joked about it. Like, oh, EDS people are pretty good looking. And that's what, Dr. Henderson said at a conference. I heard him say that and everyone in the room chuckled. But in all seriousness, the problem with that is that we don't get taken seriously. People don't understand that not all illnesses, have a look to them and like an obvious look. In fact, EDS does have a look to it. And I can almost point it out because I have like an EDS radar, kind of like a gaydar, when you're gay yourself, another person might be. And when, an autistic radar, when you're on the autistic spectrum and you can tell another person is. Well, I have an EDS radar and I can tell by the way someone's moving and standing and the way that they look and sometimes the way that they talk about their health problems, that it could be EDS that they have. Because EDS is supposedly rare, but it's not that rare. Anyhow, back to the whole notion of EDS 1, 2, and 3, the other types not being life-threatening, it's just not true. We could have so many different problems. The one of the main complications, which I'm living with and I suffer from and I really need treatment for, is the cervical spine instability and the craniocervical instability with the skull, and the ligaments that attach the skull to the neck, basically, and are responsible for turning your head and holding your head up. That's a complication that happens to a portion of us, and that is deadly. That can be deadly. I mean, I've been told that I can just have a sudden death, and that's hard. That's a hard pill to swallow. I mean, I just have to kind of operate almost by the belief that my time will come when it does. And, when I haven't had proper pain management in the past, I've considered medically assisted death because I can't get the treatment I need. I don't have the money to get the treatment I need. And if I were to continue on and on suffering and pain medication, like, has all been tried and none of it works properly or well enough anymore, then yeah, obviously the quality of life is total crap. And there's no, it's what's the point in continuing to live? But anyhow, so in that way, it's deadly because it makes you, it makes you basically suicidal, like the pain. But also, it can kill you, suddenly if you fall the wrong way. Or, like I can't turn, I've trained myself to not turn my head more than about this much. I cannot look behind me. I cannot, I can't drive because I can't shoulder check. That's not safe. And if I were to get hit, I might be really screwed. I might very badly injure or myself or die. if I got any kind of whiplash on top of having my neck like this. So, I mean, it's very dangerous. It presses on your brain stem. It's right, the C1, C2 is right where your vertebral artery is. Can't talk today. Vertebral artery, that's responsible for the circulation in your body. If that gets cut off, then your lights are out. You're done. So, yes, it's deadly. And other things can happen too, like, we still can get dissections. It's not as common with us as it is with the type 4 vascular, but the supposedly milder types of EDS, and they're not mild, by the way, we can have an aortic dissection. We can have a splenic rupture. We can have GI, intestinal stenosis and rupture, which is really serious because we have slow gut. We have motility problems with our guts. And sometimes, intestines have actually like shut down for some people, and they've had to be flushed. And I mean, it's messy and it's very serious and can be very deadly. And we have comorbid problems like mast cell activation disorder, which is like an overproduction of histamine or a difficulty with breaking down histamine, which is the chemical produced when you have an allergic reaction. So some people can have anaphylaxis and die of that. What else? There's people have comorbid autoimmune problems, circulatory issues, infections. We're more prone to infections, so secondary stuff, comorbidities of all kinds that we can develop. Dysautonomia, can kill you. You can have a heart attack from POTS. It is Sorry, I'm just getting a message here. It is uncommon to die of POTS. POTS is post-orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. So it's a form of dysautonomia. And because Ehlers-Danlos people have kind of floppy veins that, move when we move kind of thing, because we're elastic, right? Like we're elastic and soft. We can develop circulatory dysfunction. And POTS is one of those disorders, although POTS can also be developed because of autoimmune problems and issues with the neck. I have to take beta blockers for my POTS, and I have a port in my chest for weekly IV fluids for my POTS. I take Flornef and a couple other things, mainly the beta blocker and the Flornef and the infusions. And sometimes I take hydrolyte when I need to. That's an electrolyte drink. If I didn't do those things, I would be have totally unstable POTS. It's mostly stable because of that. But you can, people's heart rates have gone crazy high with unstable POTS. And yes, you can have a heart attack. It's not super common, but it is possible. There have been people that I've seen online in the community that ended up in the hospital with extremely high heart rates and had a total crash. Like their hearts stopped, and that's pretty scary. So, yeah, other forms of Ehlers-Danlos other than vascular can kill you, and either by neglect, because we get very badly neglected in a lot of medical systems, unfortunately. A lot of specialists, they don't want to deal with Ehlers-Danlos, which is like we need to change that, obviously. We are talking about changing it. We need to speak out. In Canada, there's a nonprofit group that is fighting for better care. They opened one clinic in Toronto. They tried to get a neurosurgeon. Long story, they ended up getting a neurosurgeon and he killed his wife and went to jail. Nobody expected that to happen, but it was pretty devastating for all of us. He was a good surgeon, but he obviously had issues. And now we don't have a neurosurgeon and we haven't had one for a while. And we were trying to work on that before the pandemic hit, and then that screwed up everything. So, I mean, all over the world, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome is neglected. The care is neglected. I've had to keep myself afloat. Like, I can't even begin to open up that can of worms of what I had to do to keep myself afloat, with supplements and enzymes that I'd order off the internet, to break down fiber and, glandulars, adrenal. I had adrenal dysfunction with my adrenal glands from pushing myself all the time with weak, tissues. That's what I think happened, but that's my theory. Just, you know, I don't even want to open it up. Tons of different supplements and particular diets and everything that I had to do, it really took away from my ability to do my music and, you know, my ability to spend lots of quality time with my kids. I did spend some time with them, but it takes up so much of you. It's such a job, and we have to work so hard at it and do so much ourselves because the doctors aren't doing enough for us. And we spend a lot of money out of pocket. I mean, I don't have a lot of money to spend. And I've had to even end up, you know, be cornered into raising money a few times to go to the States to get some things assessed and diagnosed so that I could come back home and figure out how to help myself again. It was pure discrimination, and I'm not going to open up my story because my story was really bad, but there are, you know, I almost died a few times. You know, there was one time when I was 85 pounds, my GI system shut down on me. And at that point, you know, my dad and my husband were like, you know, if you don't give her care, like, we're going to sue you, you know. And at that point, I was linked up with an internal medicine doctor. But let's just talk about looking sick versus not looking sick. At that time, I looked really sick. Like, you should see pictures of me. I looked ill. I looked terrible. I was bone thin, skeletal. My face was skeletal. I looked much older than my age because I was ill. You know, dark, dark circles, a yucky, like ash gray, yellowy color. Because I was having issues with my pancreas and my gut and vitamin problems, vitamin deficiencies, dental stuff. That was really painful thanks to the vitamin stuff. I didn't want to get into the damage that was done to my teeth. And just, I was almost dead. Like I was afraid my heart was going to stop. Like I felt so weak and so sick. And yeah, I reversed that. And one internal medicine doctor that believed me, reversed it. I'm kind of getting into too much right now, but what I'll say is that I almost died and I was that close. And even today, even though I look much better, I gained weight, I'm on, you know, medications. I have to be on pain medication, unfortunately. I'm opioid dependent. I take Tylenol every day, and that worries me for the sake of my liver. Gabapentin, a whole bunch of stuff, but, you know, probably about 13 or 14 medications in total that I have to take, and have a special diet and everything. I'm also diabetic. Do I look it? No, I don't. And I constantly get all this stuff like, you don't look sick, you're a faker, you're a bee with an itch, you're a, you know, like crazy, horrible abuse, right? And I'm dealing with an illness that is potentially fatal, and I'm fighting it like a mofo, and people are, you know, hating on me and stuff. And I mean, whatever. I mean, there are also people that support me and love me, and I appreciate them. So I don't want to give the haters too much, like clout here, but there's also just a lot of people that misjudge. They just almost refuse to believe that we could be dealing with this. But anyway, my point was Ehlers-Danlos is a sneaky beast. It doesn't look as bad as it is by far. And in the end there, when I got sick in, I guess it was about 2015, 2016, I looked sick and harsh. And that was because I was so exhausted and so sick that I couldn't self-care. And I gave up. I didn't moisturize my face anymore. I didn't do anything for myself in terms of self-care. And then on top of that, I just gave up on eating because eating was making me puke and making me sick. For the most part, I was eating like soft cereal and just totally under eating because I couldn't. I was not able to care for myself anymore. And at that point, I looked bad. And sadly, at that point that I looked bad, really bad, was when I finally got some medical attention happening. That's pretty sad, you know, that it had to end up that way. Because today I believe that I'm damaged. Like, I believe that the ligament damage in my neck is from that time period of neglect. Because that time period went on for 2 or 3 years at least, where I had insufficient pancreatic insufficiency, and I was, you know, my nails were coming off and my teeth were, you know, dying decaying and dying for no reason, had to get some pulled, and like I was just a corpse. So, and I could have died. I could have just died in my sleep. I was so weak. But anyway, so many things can make us sick and kill us, and the pain of EDS is nasty. It's deep, it's like nasty, it's like arthritis pain, but in its own right, nasty. It's just, it's right in your joints. It's like fibromyalgia, arthritis, and then bone pain as well, and tendinitis. We have tendinitis throughout most of our tendons, and it doesn't look like anything, sure, but it's extremely painful. So yeah, EDS is an invisible beast. Please don't judge, you know, people based on how they look. It's, and even how they act, you know, even if you don't like them, you don't like me because I'm quirky and whatever, like have some respect for what I'm fighting, possibly, would be nice. I mean, you know, I can't make change people or make people think a certain thing, certain way rather. But, yeah, EDS is an invisible beast. Other forms of EDS other than type 4 vascular do kill, whether that's quickly or slowly, or causes someone to have, you know, to misuse alcohol and drugs, or, you know, commit suicide. Trigger warning here, sorry about mentioning that, but there have been a handful of people with EDS in the community that have committed suicide, or drank too much by accident when they were depressed and just didn't come back because we're sensitive. And we can't really do that. I myself have struggled in the past with substance misuse because I wasn't getting any help and people were being cruel to me and I was very depressed, you know? So, I mean, I don't want to open up my story, but I've been through hell, and I'm still going through hell in my own way, but I'm trying to rise above it. I'm trying to make a little slice of heaven and hell by, you know, doing my makeup, even though my hand shakes because of my neck, you know, and whatever. But anyway, EDS is invisible. Please don't judge people when they say they're in pain and they're sick. Please don't judge people because you see them in a wheelchair one day and walking another. You don't know what their battle is like. You don't know what their life is like. Maybe educate yourself instead of judging.